I'm shaking life like a leaf these days, trembling. So something really huge must be on its way. And it's the most auspicious evening, the 26th, heading into the 27th. This is the time when I've had some tremendous spiritual breakthroughs. And something happened today which is so noticeable that I couldn't help but notice this is something really, really important is about to take place. I got on a scale, a vehicle scale, and suddenly the whole scale was rocking like this. I said, wow, what's going on, an earthquake or something? I realized a truck behind me had gotten on the scale. And the man says, hey, do you want to pay for the truck's load too? And I said, I don't know. He says, it's 44,000 pounds. That's 22 tons. Yeah, 44,000, the number 44. And this super heavy weight, this truck, I had been following this truck and couldn't get past it, actually. It was going so slow, I couldn't, but it was too dangerous to get past it. And finally, I was able to get past it. And then, lo and behold, it comes up and jumps on the scale with me, which it's not supposed to do. So finally, it backed off the scale. I managed to get it off the scale. And so my load was very light at that point, you know. 44,000. I mean, the whole thing. And after I got off the scale, I said, oh my gosh, this is some big message to me. I'm not exactly sure what it means, but it means something very big, to say the least. Either something very heavy is coming that doesn't bother me, or I'm able to shed something really heavy that I shouldn't be carrying around. That's not my burden to carry, you know, not for me to pay for that. One of those two. I asked the man, what's the highest weight you've ever had? And he says, well, 93,000 pounds, but 80,000 pounds is the actual legal limit. But that's 40 tons. So you got these trucks on the road that can carry 40 tons. That's a lot. That's a whole lot. I mean, it. But I felt the weight of 22 tons there. That was really something. So ever since that dream, I've been shaking. I mean, this is very intense, this dream of the tiger. And these are the intense days. Oh, by the way, the moon is going to be full on the 27th. Isn't that interesting? Full moon, October 27th. I've been saying for quite some time, October 27th for me is the key day of the year. This is what I look forward to. And lo and behold, the 111th World Series starts, and in my dream, everything came crashing down on Highway 111. Now, still open-minded about what's going to happen here. Also, the ability to shift out of the personality. A couple days ago, I was able to do this. I haven't been able to do it since. I think it was so intense that I haven't quite been able to, you know, it's still the reverberation of this is so strong. It's such a profound situation. But I'm trying. I say I am the only authority there is. Now, this is not speaking about my personality. This is speaking about spirit. Meaning I say I am the only authority there is. It's spirit declaring its freedom from personality. This is what it means. So I've done some graphic videos with slides that I am the only authority. I am the only authority there is. This means spirit is saying this to personality. I am the only authority there is. There is no other authority. It doesn't mean Jesus is the only authority or Ron Harshi is the only authority. All the teachers are speaking of is from spirit, meaning spirit is the only authority. That they're giving us tips of how to get free of the personality. Okay, so I am the only authority that there is. There is no other authority. Meaning there are not two authorities, the spirit and personality, spirit and ego. There's just one authority, and that is God, which is all, which is means it's my spirit, it's your spirit, it's all spirit. So I am the one authority. I am the one authority. I'm the only authority that there is. I was practicing that today, and it's very, very, very profound. So it's super close, this what is needed to, you know, happen is very, very close. It's shaken me up. I'm going through a time when I'm cleaning everything up, getting in shape, cleaning everything up, getting everything right. And but wow, it is so intense. As a matter of fact, I was at the computer earlier today, and I was so tired, and I got so I said, oh my gosh, this is just pulling me down so extremely strongly, the tiredness. And I had to get up and stagger over to the bed and fall on the bed and go and rest, almost like I was going to collapse. I could hardly make it. So there's some sort of, is it the collapse of the personality structure that is coming? Quite possible. Today I said, okay, I'm ready. I'm no longer need to look at impermanence. I no longer need to look at perishability. There's everywhere you look in perishability, you see perishability. Okay, everywhere you look in impermanence, you see impermanence. It doesn't matter how beautiful it is. The fact is, the impermanence is there. The perishability is there. So what's the point? Unless you like seeing perishability, which I don't, then why even look at it? And I realized that today, looking around, I said, it's useless. You know, it's useless. What am I looking for? What am I trying to see? All I'm going to see is perishability when you look through the eyes of the ego, the personality, the spirit pretending to not be what it is. So I said, I'm ready to stop looking at that. Absolutely. It's got to happen now. It's going to happen now. I've already done it. So here we go. The 111th World Series set to start. The NBA basketball season set to start, but more important, the 111th World Series, which was predicted in a dream that there would be this tremendous, something would happen, 111. Very, very crucial. I don't know if it's a collapse of the personality structure, collapse of the egoic defensiveness, you know, a drug epidemic, something significant. There's no question that great significance is going to happen now. This is how I see it. Full moon in October, very, very, very auspicious. October 27th. And I think a lot of us are feeling this, that we need to get our lives in order, right? This is what I've been doing. Absolutely is what I've been doing. Coming across a lot of dirt and junk and just, you know, stuff like, I had to deal with a lot of stuff today. Just ate a lot of dust. And it wasn't a pleasant thing at all, but I did it. Very unpleasant job I had today. It's like, my gosh, I didn't know it was that bad. Holy cow. So, you know, when we expose the dirt in our lives and in the personality lives, like, oh my God, that's horrible, horrible. Look at this, awful. But, you know, what do you do? You clean it up. You clean it up. So we may be experiencing, I mean, people may be experiencing breakthroughs, breakdowns, breakthroughs. Basically, it's the same thing, isn't it, really? You look at it half empty or half full. If you look at it half full, it's a breakthrough. If you look at it half empty, it's a breakdown. What we're training ourselves to look at it half full. And this enables the abidance to take place, which is what is needed. But there's no question there's something on my nerves, you know, very strong. And it's not subsiding. When I lay down to sleep, my whole body was just like, seemed to be just beneath the surface, just shaking, absolutely shaking. I said, what in the world is going on? Wow. Now on the surface, I remained calm, but not underneath. No way. And what does this mean? An earthquake is coming? You know, I don't know. A spiritual quake? Forty-four has both negative and positive connotations. The positive connotations are very, very, very profound, meaning a great structure and momentum and effectiveness through reason, and which is certainly good news. And then the other is that it's the negative thing, that it's isolation, that it's trying to do it on your own, trying to avoid this. It's kind of the flip side. You know, everything has a flip side, the personality side and the spiritual side to it. So something profound is in the works. It's just without any question about it. So you just have to face that and expect you may be feeling some nervousness right now. It's very possible. So from a spiritual standpoint, I would say we could be facing a lot of nervousness right now. I had the baseball preview. I turned on the Major League MLB channel, baseball preview channel, World Series, and I had to turn it off. I had to turn it off. The commercials were so sickening. I had to turn it off. I'm having some interesting input from people, actually. And it's along the lines that all the videos have talked about. Maybe people don't want to hear it, but there's an enormous negativity taking place in the world. I've spoken about it, so I'm so tired of speaking of it. You know, it takes so much effort. The world has really gone bad, like in a black hole. And it's social programming. It's social programming. You know, I'm not saying all the people in the world have gone bad. Not all of us. But there is an intense effort to program us socially underway. And that is very, very wicked what is taking place. I just say, I can't, I have to turn this off. I don't even think I'll watch the World Series, actually. The commercials are too hideous. They're all in now. And just the roles of women and men portrayed in the commercials are just revolting, just utterly revolting. You know, devils, you know, they're portraying devils, both. The men are shown being fascinated by these devil women, you know, in the commercials. And this is what the social engineering is showing. We're supposed to be fascinated by this devil woman motif. Materiality, you know, everything negative. This world is a rehabilitation center. This is what it actually is. This is the purpose of this world. We come here for rehab. And what's happening right now is there's this global movement, social engineering movement, for everyone to say to refuse to do rehab and say, you know, and it's sort of like, you know, protest and strike against it and say, we're not going to do rehab. We're just going to go back into our old bad habits here. And it's like a revolution, you know, against rehab, which is the worst thing possible. This place is needed for our rehab. We have no choice but to rehab. We're simply pretending to be something we're not, and we have no choice but to end this pretending at some point. What we are can never change. God created us can never be changed. So we have to go through this rehab. This world is for our rehabilitation. So we should take our rehab with the utmost seriousness here and work at it our entire lives. It's needed. We have so many bad habits that have been going on for so long and have been reinforced in to an extraordinary extent that, you know, a lifetime of rehab here is almost like a drop in the bucket compared to all the efforts we've made for bad habits. So, you know, to spend a lifetime here in rehab, this is what we're supposed to do. This is unquestionably what we're supposed to be doing here. So what I've done, I realized I had habits. I had to break the habits. There's no choice. So you just take rehab very seriously, but nobody else here seems to take it seriously at all. This is just extraordinary. Only a few people you find take it seriously. Just a few of us here, it seems like. And this is terrible for the world and for all of us. It's so easy, you know, to right now to reject and say no. You know, we're going to revolt against this. It's like inmates revolt in asylum, revolting and say, we're not going to get any therapy here. Well, guess what? If you don't do it now, you're going to have to do it later. So it's an astonishing what has happened here, that people simply fritter their lives away and refuse to do the rehab work. Rehab work is difficult. Rehab is difficult, but you have to do it. I guess, and they tell themselves, well, you know, if I just avoid it, then I'll die, and that's it. I don't have to do it anymore. This is a lie. This is the lie we're telling ourselves. We continue on in the realm of perishability, in the mirage. Mirage-like, illusional realm, dreamlike realm of perishability. Okay, we continue in that, until we do our rehab. No way around it, because we'll continue to pretend that we're something we're not. And we keep thinking that we can force God into admitting defeat and saying, okay, you know, we think that we can say, well, we can force God to say, well, you know, I have to accept that what I created as perfect and unchangeable has actually been changed, is no longer as perfect, and I got no choice but to accept that. This will never happen, but this is what we're betting on, you know. But when we refuse rehab, we're betting that we can change God, so that God can say, okay, you win. You know, you did change what I created perfect and unchangeable. You have a stronger will than I do. You're able to change it, so now you're perishable and impermanent and subject to fear and needs and all this stuff, and I have no choice but to accept this. This can never happen, but this is what everyone here is betting on. It's a losing bet. It's a losing bet, absolutely losing bet, but it's they're so confident when they double down. They're bluffing. You know, they say, oh, you know, we've got to just pretend like, you know, we're going to win this bet. That is very unnerving here to those who are trying to do rehab. It's very unnerving, and many who came here to do rehab have lost their will to do so, and they've just kind of given up. This is a huge problem. Interesting, very interesting. My driveway was blocked today, trying to get out, and I had to go talk to somebody, and he had a truck. And I started talking with him, a nice man. And I said, hey, is this the new F-150? He said, yeah. I said, wow, is this the 215, or, you know, or did the 216s come out yet? I don't know. I said, 215, or what is it? He said, yeah, 215. I said, holy cow, what a nice looking truck that is. How's it drive? Then he gave me a breakdown how it drives and how it hauls with boats and stuff, you know, and which is interesting, because the new F-150's got aluminum body, I think, a lot of aluminum in the truck, which makes it like about 750 pounds, I believe, lighter. So it's a lot lighter. That's a lot lighter, isn't it? That's just extraordinary. So it's a much lighter truck. But he says, you know, I was worried that, you know, wouldn't carry, you know, heavy boat and all this, but actually it does fine. And he says the acceleration, you wouldn't believe the power and the torque. He says it's just fabulous torque and power in this thing. And he said the luxury and the comfort, he says, is just through the roof. He says, the best truck I've ever owned, the new F-150. Well, it's going to cost you a lot of money for sure. But very good review from the F-150. And here we go again with a lighter vehicle. We're on the scale, and it's weighing, I weigh in at 44,000 plus pounds. And then the truck gets off the scale, and I'm super light. You'll say, and here's this. Earlier in the day, there's this truck that's much lighter than before, and it's got more power, more acceleration, you know, and does a great job of towing heavy stuff too. So all around, great truck. Very interesting stuff happening here. It's the first time I've talked to someone with one of these, the new F-150s. So there's something about lightening up, that no longer having this load of being significantly lighter. As a matter of fact, there's another motif. I won't get into what it is, but the same thing, lightening up the vehicle, also happened today. So it seems like that I'm going to go through a huge lightening up of my vehicle, so to speak. I need to, because I'm under siege right now. It's terrible. From a personality standpoint, I'm in an awful situation. But I simply have to assert that I'm the only authority there is. There is no other authority, you know. And get out of the personality. There's no other way. Invite the personality into my home and say, all projections come into my house, and you're no longer at projections. You know, it's just one spirit now, just the oneness. So maybe this is what I'm so jittery about. There's some sort of spiritual quake about to happen, a complete reformation, so to speak, where all projections are absorbed, as it were, no longer being projected, and now we're just stillness, completely still. So a vast stillness, a vast peace may come upon me. That is possible. This is what I want. This is what I've been aiming for. I don't know exactly what it's like or what to expect. You know, I don't know. How could we know? It's necessary. The social engineering that's going on this planet right now is demonic to the ultimate extent, meaning it is leading us away from rehab. Okay, this is the purpose we came here for, is rehab. And to not do the spiritual rehab we need is to completely waste our lives, really. Total waste. And not only that, but to dig a hole for more lives. Dig a very big hole. And so this is a tragedy that's happening here. And I don't think the majority of people on the planet like this. But the powers that be, you know, our projected thoughts are, chickens are coming home to roost, and you know, we're getting hit with all this stuff. It's just extraordinary. It's happening so fast now. The takeover, as I've mentioned over and over and over again, there's a social engineering program happening in this world involving women and men. The women are heavily involved in it. Very intensely involved, some of them, the ones who are committed to that. Now, the ones that are committed to rehab, that's a different story, right? And then there's a lot that are undecided, that can be easily, you know, tilted towards, you know, not doing rehab. So if you're doing rehab, you know you're doing rehab. It's all good, right? Whoever you are, if you're really doing rehab, you know you are. So there's, and if you know you are, you're aware probably that there's this effort of social engineering to get you to not do it. You know, whether you're a woman or a man, the goal is to get everyone to stop it. Thinking that if we all stop it, we can force God into accepting that we have changed what we are. This is the demonic program, is to try to force God into admitting defeat by none of us doing rehab. And saying, God, your plan of rehab has failed. It doesn't work. We've decided to reject it. And we're going to go with the personality as our true self. And then God is ignoring all this. I mean, God doesn't pay any attention to all this silly little, you know, silliness, really. The Holy Spirit has already saved all of us, actually, from our own, you know, whimsical silliness and continuity fear. But the heaviness of these times is off the charts. Now, I speak of the extreme heaviness of these times. What happened on this scale? Okay, this vehicle scale I was on. I had a very light load. Okay, not a heavy load, a very, very light load. Extraordinarily light load. This truck jumped on the scale right behind me with 44,000 tons. So when I say that the world is getting very heavy, there's a very, very heavy troubles coming. Didn't that symbolize it? 44,000 tons, isn't that what the 44th president of the United States is right now? Yes, it is. It's symbol of the times. Yes, it is. And what happened was there was a bunch of cars that got vehicles that got behind this heavy truck, so they couldn't back off the scale. And I said, oh man, I'm trapped. And the way master said, no, I'll get him off, don't worry. He's a very confident guy, this guy. Very interesting guy. Very smart, very confident. And he said, wait, says, don't worry, I'll get him off. And the guy in the truck, 44,000 pound truck, jumped out and ran back and started talking to the others. Says, get back up. Everybody, the whole line backed up. Then the truck was able to back off the scale. And suddenly I was lightened up, you know. So it could symbolize that all this heaviness that's in the world, this very, very heavy agenda of social engineering, is going to, somehow I'm going to be able to get it off my back, you know, get it off of me. So I'm very, very light and agile and light. Very possible, this is what it means. Because this stuff, those who are doing rehab know how difficult it is to do, right? How difficult is it even to watch the videos? People are having trouble watching the videos now. It's becoming prohibitively difficult. That's fine. I understand this. I understand the times here. We need something stronger, right? We need something lighter, that is really light. Really light. And so, we, you know, that this can pick our spirits up. Because the heaviness of this world, of this agenda to get us to all default on our rehab, so we can try to then, you know, blackmail God into admitting defeat. this is extraordinarily heavy, and it's weighing on everybody right now. We're all weighed down, just like I was weighed down by 44,000 pounds today. This truck was so heavy, it was going 5 miles an hour. I got stuck behind it. You know, I was stuck. This is interesting, isn't it? We're stuck behind this agenda right now in the world. You know, just the 44th president of the United States just is a, symbolizes the global social engineering agenda. And I couldn't pass. I was stuck. I was going so slow. I said, oh my gosh. I was thinking like maybe I should go around, but it was too dangerous. The vehicles that could have come in. And actually, if I tried to pass, I would have gotten in an accident. So I really had no choice but to just, you know, bide my time, and then finally I was able to zip around it. And but then it, you know, still it still cost me trouble. So very symbolic. This is very, very symbolic. We are in a brutally difficult time now. We're being led down the primrose path away from rehab, spiritual rehab. I come from a long line of greatness and non-dual greatness. My teachers that I've paid attention to my entire life are the most extraordinary teachers in history. You talk about Buddha, you talk about Jesus, you talk about Adi Shankar, you talk about Longchenpa, you talk about Ram Maharshi, you talk about Sri Sri Anandamayama, then you talk about Jesus with A Course in Miracles. This is my lineage, okay? These are the teachers I've paid attention to my entire life here, because they're the rehab. They're the ones with the rehab program, okay? And so, you know, this they have told us this place is for rehab. You got to do it, and they've admonished me that you have to do it. You have no choice. You have to get after it, and you have to apply yourself very, very intensely with great discipline at this and keep working at it no matter what. So this is my complete focus in my life. So I'm very aware that there's an attempt to undermine this and completely lead all of us astray. This is a fact. This is a fact. And they're really playing hardball right now. Very hardball. The women and the men engaged in this. The women are playing, as I said, the devil woman, and the man is playing the role of being spellbound by the devil woman. You know, this is the thing, and they're portraying this to the public in all sorts of different ways that basically says, you know, get your attention off of rehab. Get your attention off of rehab. So for me, this is catastrophic. You know, my whole life is based on rehab. This is the only thing that's important. Spiritual rehab. And it works. It works. You know, I've been able to just shift off the personality. I've been able to practice that and see, oh, yes, it's absolutely possible to bring the light in here. And these great teachers have told us it's absolutely possible for you to do this. If you do the rehab, it will happen for sure. They guarantee it for us. As Ram Maharshi guaranteed for me that I'm going to be enlightened. He guaranteed it. He says, I already know. I already see it. You're absolutely going to succeed. And so this is very important. This time, the heavy, heavy-handed attempt to distract us. It's an overall agenda. And there's some experts in the world, unfortunately, many who... I was in a doctor's waiting room today. I took someone to the doctor. And this huge waiting room must have been 50 seats, the biggest one I've ever seen, my gosh. And it was like tremendously busy, many, many doctors. There are four different wings to this area with many, many doctors. And of course, everybody in there had some affliction. But the thing that struck me was the people in there. I said, these people are messed up. It's more than just a, you know, they have spiritual afflictions here. It's extraordinary. And the tattoos are just off the charts. And the attitudes of these people, I mean, my God, I mean, they're all messed up. I felt like out of place, like I was like, you know, I'm in the wrong place here. I mean, I was shining with you know, I mean, all the spiritual discipline and work, and I'm feeling like, you know, yes, I can, yes, I will, yes, I've already done it, and I am the only authority there is, meaning spirit. I am the only authority there is. My personality has zero authority at all. And I said, I'm never going to be sick. This is my authority. I can't be sick. I can't be infirm. You know, rehab is must be done. I must do rehab. I must do rehab. That's what I was saying there. I must succeed at rehab. That rehab is the only purpose there is. And I realized all these people on here, they're not doing rehab. You know, and I saw the mechanism of the medical, what's going on right now, and it is a complete collapse of our health in the world. People are obsessed with medical procedures right now, absolutely obsessed, and going to the doctor. Everyone's sick. They're sick because they're all investing in the personality, which is inherently sick. It's inherently believing in sickness, that we've changed what we are. We're perfect. How can we, if we're pretending we're something we're not, we have to pretend we're imperfect. And this imperfect imperfection knows no bounds, too. Right? It just is everywhere. And so, you know, it's showing up. All these people, now, I couldn't believe it. The low vibration, the low rehab, I mean, the sickness, spiritual sickness in there was so profound. I said, oh God, what am I in, hell? Well, yeah. I mean, it just brought the light. I'm in hell here. These poor souls, you know, these poor spirits are not doing their rehab. They're going to the doctor instead. The doctors have taken over the medical profession in all its ramifications, has taken over for spiritual rehab on this planet. And people think, all I got to do is go to the doctor. There's some procedure. There's so many procedures taking place. There's so many procedures. People are having everything replaced in their knees, their shoulders, their hips. You name it, they're having replacements. Someone just told me, oh yeah, I'm having both knees replaced. Yeah, my knees are getting a little old. I'll just go in and have titanium knees put in. It's no problem. People are having hips constantly. I mean, the surge in medical procedures is off the charts. And now they're, you know, everyone's has to be insured. Why? To pay for all this stuff. I have never had a single procedure in my life other than have a tooth pulled, and I don't plan on having any. But yet, I'm pouring in all my work, it basically goes to pay for insurance. I don't have anything left over. And the rates keep going up and up and up. Why? Paying for all these procedures everyone's having. This is their belief. This is their thing. And spiritual rehab is, no, I am the only authority there is. Nothing can happen except that I choose for it to happen. Nothing whatsoever. And I realized this today. I said, hey, my experiencing is, I'm completely in charge of my experiencing. I'm the only authority there is. There is no other authority. That means I'm in charge of my experiencing 100%. There's not a single exception to this whatsoever. And I accepted this. This is the truth. I am the only authority there is. That means if I don't want to be sick, I can't get sick. It's impossible. I can be perfectly well all the time. And this is what spiritual rehab is all about, you see. You know, that's an aspect of it. These people are becoming just extremely reliant on drugs and the medical profession. Now, I have a terrible problem with an issue, a functional issue, structural issue, but it's been really bad for about a year. And I say, no, but I'm not going to a doctor. This is my responsibility. I'm choosing this. So I'm the only authority there is on this, actually. And so when I choose for it to get better, it has no choice but to get better. You know, no choice whatsoever. Yesterday I was doing some sort of exercise, and just kind of with my wrists, and it got better. And today, actually, it was way better today than it's been in like a year's time. And speaking of that, I had to change my golf swing again because I discovered my back. The one I had was hurting my back too much. And I did find a new swing, completely new swing, that didn't hurt my back at all. All hands and wrists, which is very fascinating. As I say, that golf tends to mirror your spiritual life. It reflects it. So, and I talked to somebody recently who said something very interesting, that when the first time he played golf, he played great. He said he never played golf in his life. And he just went out there, just naturally said, this is how I want to do it, and just hit it great, and almost beat some people who've been playing golf for a long time. First time he's ever stepped on a golf course. He said, it was easy. He said, I don't have any problem. I just see the ball, I hit the ball. And then people are telling him, no, you're not doing it right. You're not doing it right. Here, let us fix you. You're supposed to stand, hold like club like this, stand like this, swing like this. And so after he got all these lessons, people tell him how to swing, he went out the next time, and he couldn't play at all. He said, it just absolutely... I couldn't play, and he never played again. He said it was just horrifying what happened. And he said, you know what, if I just had just left me alone, if I just did it the way I felt naturally, I would have been fine, but I got all messed up. And I thought about that. I said, wow, that's really interesting. I'm going to take that to heart, you know, and think about this. So here I am, and I'm practicing the golf swing, and I suddenly feel this pain in my back, and I'm aware it was because of the torque of the swing. This is what was causing the back problem. I said, wow, I have to quit it. Now that I realize it really is, it's too extreme. And I said, what can I do that doesn't hurt the back? And then I said, well, and I just came up with a swing that was all wrists and hands, completely crazy swing. I just loop it a certain way and just come through and just whip it through with my hands and arms, wrists, and hands, no back at all. And the actual swing speed increased. Not only that, but the consistency was fabulous. Every swing was exactly the same. I said, wow, here's a swing. Now I'm looking on the internet tonight about wristy golf swing, and I come across this famous golf teacher who says, what you're looking for in a swing is a swing you can repeat time and time and time and time again, a repeatable swing. And I said, you know what, you're right. You're absolutely right. That is really what you're looking for, is to be able to repeat it. Because usually the swings, you know, you might swing good once and the next one is a little wild, doesn't repeat itself. What do the pros do? They repeat their swing every single time. They have a repeatable swing. It doesn't really matter what the swing is, to tell you the truth. What's important is it's repeatable. And I found this new swing I had was repeatable. And so I said, well, I got something here. Really, it doesn't hurt the back, and it's repeatable. Now, you won't find a swing in any golf, you know, no golf teacher will ever teach you the swing, right? But who cares if you find a swing that's repeatable, you know, and it's got, you know, high swing speed, repeatable, doesn't hurt your back, doesn't hurt you at all, you feel great. There you go. So, orthodoxy often screws us up, is what I'm saying. The orthodoxy of the personality thinks it knows everything. It really does. It thinks it's an expert on everything. But it just messes us up. And the funny thing is, this swing reminded me of when I was young and I had a swing. This was a natural swing for me. I said, let me just do it this way. And then somehow I got going into orthodoxy of, well, you need to stand like this and the hips have to turn and then the elbow and this arm and everything. It's all mechanical, like a robot, you know, and you're supposed to swing that way. And I said, okay, that's how the pros do it. Then that's how they do it. No, the pros are freaks of nature. They have super great timing and coordination, and they hit it dead in the dead, you know, sweet spot every time. And they also are able to whip it through really, really, really well. So, but you cannot necessarily copy the pros. This is not a good idea. So I said, I'm just going to do it this way. You know, it feels great. It feels great. And stop. So it's another evolution in spirituality of doing what really works and what's repeatable, which means what? Abidance. Abidance, abidance, abidance. The personality will never go into abidance, because it's trying to get spirit to abide in personality, which freaks it out. It can't happen. But we can have personality abide in spirit, invite it into our home where it goes still, where it goes quiet, because we tell it that's what it, we're the sovereign authority and the only authority there is. And so you have no authority, so therefore you're quiet. Personality goes quiet. We don't have to attack it. We don't have to kill the personality. We don't have to destroy it. Don't have to disengage. Don't have to detach from it. Don't have to do anything. Just invite it back into our house, the one home that is everywhere. And it then goes quiet. And it's like that. And so this is not what the personality would recommend at all. And so most teaching in the world is personality spirituality. 99.9% is. And when we try to do it that way, it just doesn't work. It just doesn't work. And it hurts us and all these problems, all these troubles. So we just do it the natural way, the way that really works, is invite our projections back home. Call our projections back home. This is what works. You rarely do hear anything like that ever taught. This teaching here seems very unorthodox, but it's not really. It's not really. It's actually pragmatic what works. So, you know, I hope to try out that swing at some point. And, you know, just let it go. Let it fly. Tee it high and let it fly. We'll see how it works on the course, right? There's a tendency when on the golf course to try and be orthodox because, you know, other people are looking at you and you think, oh, I want them to think that I've really studied the game and really knowledgeable and you know what's orthodox and or what's right. And then it creeps into your game. It ruins it. It ruins it. Just like that, the guy that told me, you know, I first time I played great. Then everybody told me, they tried to fix all my, you know, flaws. Oh, you don't really know how to play. Let's fix it. And it messed him up. Totally messed them up. Beginner's luck, they call it, you know, right? Until the orthodox gets a hold of you. You know, you say, oh, it's not this easy. So this world gets a hold of us here, all the orthodoxy of this world tell us, you know, and we lose abidance here. We lose abidance because we're just doing so. Oh, yeah, it's easy. It's easy. I'm just abiding in truth, and I don't see perishability. I say, oh, well, you know, you're not doing it right, the right way. You need to see this, you know, there's something wrong with you. Really? Why do I need to see perishability? For what? For what? It's just a pretense, you know, it's all an illusion, it's all mirage. It doesn't lead to anything. What they're saying is, well, you need to see it so you can default, so all the rest of us who are defaulting and not doing rehab can feel good about themselves, and you don't want to make us feel bad about ourselves, do you? I say, absolutely I do, because that'll get you going. It's much better that everyone feels bad about themselves, realizing they're being lazy, than it is to make them feel good about themselves about being lazy, because that just gives them a return ticket here. What good is that? Later on, they'll curse you. You know, say, oh, you should have, you know, pushed me, and, you know. But here, everybody gets so upset. If you set a good example, they hate it. They hate it. Very few people these days, you know, ordinary people, they don't want a good example. Do they want someone super healthy? No. They want somebody who's sick like them, make them feel better about their own, you know, defaulting on rehab or trying to default, say, I'm not going to do it. Their own, you know, refusal to do rehab, they want everyone else to refuse too, make them feel better. This is the trouble here. This is so difficult now. I'm finding this. Good Lord. And I say, come on, no, you're making us look bad. God will see you and say, oh, rehab is possible. You see, they did it, so you can do it too. And they say, no, we don't want that. We don't want anybody doing rehab. So we can say, God, there's not one single example here on the planet of anybody doing rehab. So this must not be a rehab planet. You must be wrong about that. It must be a personality paradise planet, you know, where we just indulge the personality. That's what it's for. This is what the world's trying to do. Now, I'm very sincere and adamant about this. This is how I feel, though. This is what the world is doing. They're trying to undermine genuine spiritual rehab here to an extraordinary extent. We've come so far, we've fallen so far. If we look at like a real teacher who advocates real spiritual practice in the past, you know, recent past even, we look at that and say, that's crazy. Nobody can do that. What are they talking? That's great. That's nuts. That's overzealous. You know, this. No, we can't do that. We can't. They can't expect that of us. It's, well, just, you know, a little while ago, 50 years ago, it was expected. People did do it. A lot of people were devoted to rehab. Not a lot, but a heck of a lot more than now. So nowadays we're wimps. We're absolute wimps. We think spiritual rehab is like, you know, something we do like for 10 minutes in a lifetime. Oh, I did my 10 minutes. You know, now I'm done. We've lowered the bar. You know, the bar has been lowered to the point where it's not rehab at all. It's not rehab. It's like showing up at the rehab center and say, well, guess what? You know, that's good enough. We're not actually doing the rehab, but we, you know, at least we showed up here and we're going to, yeah, now we're going to party around the pool. That's not rehab. Not doing the program. Showing up and not doing the program is not rehab. So this is the situation in the world that we're facing now. Everybody's in the same boat as far as facing this attitude. Bad attitude. It affects me, it affects everybody. I feel like, wow, how can I just keep this with my, how can I set an example in this world? People say, you're crazy. I can't do this. There's no will for it. I don't feel any will for it in the world. I think people will be dilettantes. You know, okay, I'll sit down and meditate for 10 minutes or maybe half an hour, and okay, that's it. Okay, maybe again next month I'll do that, you know, or I'll do it for a week and then I'll quit for a year and then I'll do another week. And I mean, the standards have just been decimated here, decimated, decimated. Very interesting, the study coming out that red meat causes cancer, but it's only colorectal cancer is like people have a 6% chance or something like that of getting it, and it increases the 6% chance by 18%, so it's, you know, small increase in possibility. But and so the meat industry of course is very angry about this, but I saw it and I said, ah, you know what they're doing really is trying to get people eat less meat because of climate change, because meat eating is one of the main factors of climate change. Actually, is all the land that's being cleared for grazing, you know, sheep, goats, pigs, beef, especially beef for meat. They're converting forests into pasture land. This has been going on for a long, long, long time. This is one of the major problems, because trees, what they take CO2, I believe, out of the atmosphere, right? They're the great, you know, converters that keep it's the engine. You cut down all the forests and we are going to have a severe problem. So I believe that they're, you know, saying that red meat causes cancer, to lessen the amount of meat that people eat. It's a perfect example of they say, well, it's as bad as smoking cigarettes, but they mean it's in the same, they say we have the same proof level, but they're trying to say, well, it's just as bad as smoking cigarettes. Well, you know, this is, you know, highly odd science. And they say, well, not, we don't really mean that. What we mean is that the link is just as strong a link between 18% increase in colorectal cancer among those who are subject, the 6% subject to it, or it increases their risk or something. There's just as much a link, provable scientific link of that, is there a provable scientific link about smoking cause cancer? But then they and equate it with smoking, you know, and the you know, it's statistics, you know, there's three kinds of lies: lies, damn lies, and statistics. And this is, you know, there, funny science is, you know, science is being used for social engineering. There's no question about it. It's very deceitful. I don't eat meat at all. I'm a vegetarian. I don't think meat's good for anybody. But lots of people eat meat, and it doesn't. It's not a problem for them, you know. It's the hormones. It's the stuff. It's the vibration. It's. You eat meat, you become more bovine. You become more like an animal. Actually, I found out. Absolutely. You know, you pick up those traits in some way. I see the people that meat eaters, there's a big difference between meat eaters and vegetarians and fruitarians and all this stuff. There's a big difference, actually. You know, you go to like meat eating places like Texas, for instance, and the people are there. I mean, they look like steers. You know, I mean, they're big. They're just the way their attitudes and everything, very bovine, very bovine. The more people, I've always noticed this. People, it's just observation. You go to the Central Valley, you go to like a steakhouse like Harris Ranch Steakhouse in Central Valley, California, and the people going there, I couldn't believe it. Couldn't believe it. I said, they look like steers, like a cattle. I mean, just their attitudes, the way they walk, just the vibration, I mean, and everything. They're huge. I mean, like, whoa, because all the hormones they're getting now in the meat. And I mean, these people, like, a lot of, some people eat meat every day, red meat, you know, whether it be steak, pork. I mean, they don't eat fish or chicken hardly at all. It's, you know, hardcore lamb chops, some sort of veal, you know, lamb chops, beef, some kind of beef, whether it be hamburgers, hot dogs, steak, you know, beef stew, all sorts of ways of preparing beef. They eat beef, and then pork, they'd eat some sort of pork, bacon's pork. I mean, every day of their lives, they're eating red meat for sure. Me, I'm eating fruit and kale smoothies and some Greek yogurt. That's about it. Maybe that's causing, you know, the spiritual upsurge here, you know. Just eat your, wow, it's, I had this juice I put in that I've never tried before. It's cranberry coconut juice. It's cranberry juice with coconut syrup in it, and or coconut cream. And I never tasted it straight. I'd only poured it into the smoothies, and the smoothies taste great. I wonder, why does it taste so good? Well, I just drank some of that cranberry coconut drink. Wow, is that have a good taste to it? My gosh, it's really something. It's like the ultimate mixer or something. And so I'd pour that in there with the kale, and you know, it doesn't taste so bad. I don't know, I've only had the kale smoothies for a couple of days now. But eating a lot of fruit, it's been an intentional shift. I've had a real hard time over the last 10 years eating any fruit at all. I just stopped eating fruit. It lightens you up. It lightens you up a lot. And I felt that the times are so heavy that I needed to get heavy to deal with the times, you know? So that's why I put on a lot of weight and tried to eat heavier food, eat a lot of food, eat heavier food. No fruit. I stayed away from fruit. Only had bananas and blueberries. That's about it. But now I realize it's time to lighten up. Got to lighten up. So I'm eating, you know, mostly fruit now, actually. Let's see, you know, just hold on. Dissipating a sneeze there. Whew. Okay. Whew. Wow, just feel this huge dissipation of energy happen in the sneeze. Holy cow. Whew. Very intense there. Raspberries, berries, a lot of berries. Get frozen berries, mixed berries, strawberries. You know, this huge thing about berries. I've been having berries and now mixed fruit, frozen fruit. Grapes, peaches, cantaloupe, watermelon, apples, grapes. All these various pineapple, mangoes, all these various fruits. Mandarin oranges, apples. Yeah, just eating a mixture of fruits, blend them up and just drink this blended fruit juice, fresh fruit juice. Well, it's frozen, but flash frozen. They freeze it quickly. I don't know if that's good or not, but it's better fresh, I would assume. And, you know, losing weight and lightening up. I've gone from, you know, trying to be a heavyweight, but I realize if I keep going down this road, my health's going to fall apart. My health is falling apart. I couldn't make myself heavy enough. You know, this the heaviness that's happening in the world is just extraordinary. So now I'm going towards lightness, lightening up. What I try to do is try to make my personality really heavy, strong, real strong. Now I'm going to make it real still, you know, and completely lighten up. Completely lighten up. This is the change in the golf swing. I'm going back to a swing I used when I was real young, you know, young, and say, let me just do this. This feels natural to me. This feels where I got the power from. Completely lighten up the swing. Totally lighten it up. Same thing with the body, same with the mind, with the personality, with the spirit. I'm going to lighten up, tremendously lighten up here and see how that works in this world. You know, I don't know, but I've got to try it. Got to try it. It's essential. If we try to match the heaviness with our own heaviness, we're going to fail for sure. I know people are doing this. They're failing. Unfortunately, it's the wrong tack to take. So hopefully I can inspire everyone to lighten up. They're not doing it. I'm saying, hey, you know, look what I'm doing. And so I think people are trying match, you know, it was like sumo. Oh, there's a sumo wrestler coming after me. I better get heavier to deal with this. The social engineering is like this massive Godzilla, you know, that's after us. And just like this El Nino that has been named Godzilla El Nino, that's supposed to be, could be the strongest El Nino in recorded history. We've been recording it for only 30 years, but the surface temperature is what, like 2.5? I think it's 2.5 degrees warmer than normal. That's a lot. And it's supposed to strengthen until the end of this year. This is very significant, you know. Could be an extremely strong El Nino, which means that there could be a, you know, massive moisture coming in. Some places, you know, Texas is already getting it, and the Gulf states are getting it right now. Louisiana, Mississippi, Alabama, etc., Gulf states. And Texas has been getting hammered by precipitation for a long time now. But this El Nino is supposed to come in late autumn, early winter, and start just dumping. They're saying in California that we could be having historic floods and precipitation. I mean, they're talking about torrential rain. Possibility of torrential rain. They're saying, everybody get prepared now. Get prepared now, because we're talking about something that could be extremely strong. Well, you know, they were hyping the weather so much. Now they hyped that Hurricane Patricia so much. We thought it would see the end of the world. And, you know, nothing happened. Very fortunate that it went through an area there was almost no people there. And it went into a mountainous area that it cut its power down really quickly. But it wasn't, you know, it didn't have any storm surge because it happened so fast. I knew this was overhyped in some way, because I said, how can it generate such a massive storm surge if it just started off the coast and watered up the coast and then suddenly turned inland? It didn't have the time to generate that. Like Katrina was a hurricane way out to sea, and it spent a lot of time in the Gulf of Mexico. I mean, it had the chance to develop this huge storm surge. Those are the dangerous hurricanes, really, that are very wide and have a huge storm surge. This thing was not wide. The high winds are a very narrow area and had no storm surge hardly. So this was not the world's most dangerous. It may have been the most powerful winds. I think they clocked sustained winds 190 miles an hour when it came ashore. So the high winds are there for sure, or maybe 180. I think it was 180. That's very high. But the dangerousness of it was not nearly what they were hyping it to be. Quite interesting. But so maybe this El Nino is being hyped. The weather is nothing. It's all hype now. It's all hype. It's just crazy. And they're saying, no, we're not hyping it. Yes, they are. Yes, they are. Intelligent people are seeing that now. Super hyped. But surface temperature is surface temperature. I mean, the satellites and the don't lie. The El Nino's there. I mean, there's this huge pocket of warm water in the eastern Pacific. There's no question about this. And the trade winds are been reversed. And so there is an El Nino. Is how it plays out. We don't know exactly how it will play out, but it's going to play out one way or the other. And based on, what was it, 87 and 96 or something, 97, we've had two powerful El Ninos here over the last 30 years or so. And we got a tremendous amount of rain. It was flooding. It was just, my gosh, there was so much flooding. It was really quite amazing. And that could happen again. I mean, the reservoirs were spilling over. They're completely full. Rivers are just raging, torrents. It was intense. The amount of rain that can fall is, very significant. We're talking about, you know, get 7 inches, 10 inches, you know, 15, 20 inches. I mean, just huge amounts of precipitation is possible. So we'll see. We'll see how it goes. But this talks of the heaviness of the world, you know, the Godzilla, El Nino. We're trying to match it. How can we hold our own with this? Well, I'm going to lighten up. We'll see how that works. Super light. Super light. It's funny, that golf club I was swinging is a super light. It's a burner, 2.0 super light or something. It's so light it's hard to swing. It's almost too light. But yeah, it's super light. There again, it's another sign of becoming super light. Super light. So I'll let it happen, see what happens. It's time to lighten up. Just like I got heavier, see how that is? I say, uh-oh, okay. That's probably, you know, it's not the answer. Let's get super light. Not necessarily physically, but spiritually, emotionally, our whole belief system. Let's get super light here and see what happens. It has to, because everyone's getting super heavy. Really, everyone's on this very heavy trip, again, on heavy trips. And, you know, this is what happened in the 60s, the 50s, 40s, late 40s, 50s, going into, you know, at that time, everyone was getting real heavy. the Cold War. It was real heavy. Everyone was on a very heavy trip, very paranoid, frightened trip. Well, we had reason to, because of the nuclear Cold War, the nuclear problems there. We all thought that the world was going to end. As that song, Skeeter Davis, "Don't you know, End of the World." Don't they know it's the end of the world? It ended when you said goodbye. Why do the birds keep on singing? Why do the suns in the sky? Don't they know it's the end of the world? I've been singing that song lately. I think it's Skeeter Davis that did that song. Really nice song. And, you know, back then we thought it was the end of the world. Really. It really, 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 really was intense. Very heavy trip. And people are saying, hey, that this it's gotten too heavy. We need to lighten up. And this is when the 60s started. And what a time the 60s were, I'm telling you. I mean, it was, we discovered, you know, that it's, that some people are lightened up. It's possible to lighten up. We discovered that the saints, the gurus, the sages, etc. We said we need some examples of people who are light, who have lightened up, because we're just on too heavy of a trip. And this is maybe this is what's going to happen right now, is we need some saints, some sages, some gurus who have really lightened up, and people can say, wow, okay, it's doable. Let's go with this. You know, maybe there's something click on them and says, hey, the heavy trip is not working for me. It's too heavy. I just don't want to do it anymore. This is exactly what happened in the 60s. I was there, I know. They found out about these teachers, you know, these great teachers that were just like total light, completely light. I told you a story of Sri Sri Anandamayi, somebody saw that she was missing the train or something. They grabbed her to pull her on the train. And they pulled her on the train. And then later on they said, hey, you know, I got to tell you this, that when I grabbed you pulling the train, you had no weight at all. It was like there was nothing there. It was, you know, lighter than a feather. And I got to tell you this, I mean, I'm just shocked, you know, by this. She says, yeah. He says, yeah. It's everything just a mental projection. Everything just a mental projection, actually. And there were other times when someone tried to lift her, didn't want to be lifted, and it felt like an elephant. No one could budge her. You get, I think, five people tried to lift her and couldn't even budge her. Like an elephant. Those who are liberated sages are like this, can be like this. This is an extreme example of liberated sage. That's true. So, but they're so light, not just physically light, they're spiritually light. They are light, actually. And this helps us lighten up. So we cut the breeze of this. And unfortunately, a lot of people use drugs to lighten up. That didn't work well. That resulted in the 70s and the 80s and the 90s and the 2000s and the 2010s. The drugs are what brought all this nonsense down upon our heads, actually, because everybody they wanted to lighten up, but they didn't have the discipline. They didn't want to do the rehab, so they said, "I'll just take drugs." Big mistake, and this is what I fear right now. It's getting so heavy. The trip is getting so heavy. Is what we call the ego trip of getting head personality. Ego trip is getting so heavy right now that I believe that people are going to start taking drugs to try to lighten up. And this only makes matters worse, actually. I know there are a lot of people who say that the 60s, the drug use was really helpful for them. But, you know, I think they're just deluding themselves. This is the personality trying to say that it made the right choice. No. You know, they say, well, I have a happy personality now. No, they don't. Having a personality, you can't be happy. It's fear-based. They're still seeing what? Impermanence. They're still seeing what? Imperilment. The perishable, and that everything's in peril, right? Of perishing, right? And they say, well, yeah, but I made peace with my death, and I made peace with this. I know it's okay. I'm just gonna, you know, do my ohms and whatever. Oh, are they kidding? You know, this is not rehab. That's not rehab. They're not liberated sages. Rehab is the goal is to be a liberated sage. That's it. Stop pretending we're something we're not. We're not bodies. I'm not a body. I'm free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. Now, I lost my singing voice by lightening up. I, you know, when I was heavy, I had the tenor voice. I was able to have a tenor voice, drink some lemonade, and could belt out a tenor voice. It was tremendous. But now, gone. Tenor voice is gone. The voice is there, but it's not a tenor voice anymore. I can't do it. And singers know this. You know, I had a singing coach, a great singing coach, that told me, if you want to sound better, put on 20 pounds. I said, wow, I don't want to do that. But actually, I did it finally, and yeah, it's right. Absolutely. You drink the lemonade, tighten your vocal cords, and then you relax and use the weight and drop down into tenor register, and you can hold it. It didn't break. I was able to just belt out full blast tenor register and didn't break. I said, wow, it is possible. But I said, hey, I got better things to do than be a singer, you know. It's more important to lighten up, to help everyone else lighten up. So it's getting too heavy now, folks. It's too heavy. I can feel it. Like I got 44,000 pounds. I felt that. It's too heavy right now. Everything's getting too heavy. So people, there's no question that people are going to say, we need to lighten up. This trip isn't working for me. This whole medical trip, this whole thing, is too much. I want to lighten up. But where do you go to lighten up? If there's no enlightened sages in the world, you know, you're going to go probably to drugs, unfortunately. And people say, well, I'll do both. No, because you don't have the discipline. You're on drugs, you don't have discipline. You don't have the right discipline. You say, well, the drug's doing it for me. I don't need any discipline. And then you're off drugs, you got no discipline. This is the trouble. You need discipline. The rehab takes discipline. Just like today, I was so tired, I don't feel like taping. Well, guess what? Got to tape. People are depending on me to lighten up. You know, I said, hey, I'm going to try. So, you know, I've tried a lot more than most people have. And the trip is getting too heavy now. This trip we're on right now is too heavy in the world. The world's on a too heavy of a trip. The social engineering is getting too heavy. Enough's enough. And I know what can happen in the 60s. People said that's enough's enough. This corporate, military industrial complex corporate trip, you know, is getting too heavy. Why? Because they're trying to reverse engineer all the technology they got from extraterrestrials. And everything was kind of too secretive. You know, they were all freaked out themselves. The corporation, oh my God, we have all this knowledge, we have this power, we have these technology, oh my God, we're going to dominate the world, we're going to become like incredibly rich and powerful. But what if our competitors get this? Oh my God, we can't let the Soviets have all this technology, you know, and this paranoia, and everybody got strict, you know, everybody's in this, shh, don't tell anybody, don't talk, anybody, you just need to know basis. Everything was so paranoid back then, I'm telling you. We were all good little corporate citizens. And there's so many people working for the military, and everybody said, well, I can't tell you that. You know, it's so many secret projects were going on. This is the whole black ops thing arose. The secret governments, the secret corporations, the secret military industrial complex really running the country. That's what Eisenhower warned us about. He says, you don't know how bad it is, but I do. He didn't tell us about those extraterrestrials, but he knew. He went into Area 51, and they told him. They told his chief of staff. They told him exactly what's going on there. He became aware of it, and if he may have been at, you know, in Palm Springs, he may have met with them actually, and you know, and got clued in partially, but he didn't know everything was going on until he dug into it. So he warned us. And it was true. We it was a very heavy time with the Cold War and extraterrestrial technology, which eventually led to computers. The computers that we have at high tech digital age came from reverse engineering extraterrestrial technology and getting help from extraterrestrials to do this. And so very heavy time, and we said we need to lighten up. And we did. We lightened up. The clothing lightened up. Everything lightened up. Found a lot of spiritual teachers, started meditating, started, you know, getting into that. And reading a lot of books, spiritual books, really getting into it. The music, you know, was trying to help us lighten up. And of course, the Vietnam War was raging. Peace protests. We say, hey, it was just too intense, right? We were all going to be drafted and go into the jungles, and you know, and good luck with that. Steamy jungles of Vietnam, Cambodia, and Laos. That's and so that's that was such a heavy trip. So many heavy trips were upon us. So we rebel, we flip the script, decide to lighten up. And of course, you know, people didn't, culture didn't know, what are you doing? You know, we do, we're lighting up, man. You know, we just too heavy, man. You're this trip, you're laying a heavy trip on us, man. We don't want this heavy trip. We want a lighter trip. We want a peaceful trip. We want to, so this is what happened. Well, right now the trip is even heavier. Now, keep in mind the Roaring Twenties was, I believe, after the First World War, when there was a cocaine epidemic. Everybody wanted to lighten up. You know, jazz age, we're going to dance. We got to lighten up because we just went through this hideous war. It was terrible, World War One. My gosh, it shocked everybody. People used to think that war was something gallant and beautiful and brave, and there's something, you know, elegant and something culturally redemptive. I mean, they had a different attitude about war. Really, they did. There was something noble about war. After World War One, they said, no, I don't think so, because modern warfare dehumanized it. You know, the tanks, the airplanes, the chemical warfare, all this stuff dehumanized the war. It wasn't mano on mano anymore, really, you know. And they said, that's it. We don't, no more war. League of Nations was formed. We don't want war anymore. And the Jazz Ace came in, and the people started taking cocaine like crazy and drinking Coca-Cola, which had cocaine in it. I don't know if that time it still did. But they were using drugs and booze. I mean, Prohibition, wouldn't that end 26 or something? I don't know. They were boozing it up. They were trying to lighten up. They were trying to lighten up. Okay, so that was the first epidemic. Second epidemic was, of course, started in the 60s, when it went into the 70s, because the heaviness was we were actually, it's a funny thing that the 70s and 80s was the time when the worst drug usage, I think, and people were into severe cocaine, PCP, crack cocaine, and methamphetamine started coming in. I mean, there's hallucinogens of all. It was heavy, heavy drug use. Discoing, you know, they were using poppers and nitriles and all sorts of stimulants for sex, just crazy stimulants, you know. And I think that they were intuitively knowing that a very, very heavy time was going to come upon us, with this technology was coming, going to come upon us. And then, of course, in 1981, the personal computer, came upon us, 5150, IBM PC 5150, 1981, or July, was it 11th or 17th or something, right in there, in July 12th, maybe, July 12th. We were like partying. It's like, hey, it's last call. This is the last chance we have to party and lighten up before things get real heavy in this world. So that's kind of what happened. The 60s lightened up from the 50s, and then the 70s and 80s was a combination of lightening up from the 50s and early 60s, and then partying before the real heaviness came upon us, you know, with this distraction from rehab, really is what it is. But now we are in this time of it's just become extraordinarily intense. Now, the alcohol industry knows this, and they're running ads nonstop. They're saying lighten up by drinking booze, by boozing it up. They want to make a huge profit off of this, which they no doubt will. And, it's a funny thing. They're aiming all these ads in baseball games, which, again, a lot of young people watch baseball, actually. The ads are targeting young people. Young people. Why? Because they know young people want to lighten up. They know things are getting too heavy. They're on so many drugs, pharmaceuticals to try to lighten up. And they say, hey, you know, booze it up. That's the way. So they're trying to make, you know, huge profit off of the misery of others. And of course, I'm saying that, you know, drugs are not the way to lighten up. So most will do it with drugs. The fortunate ones will do it with spiritual teachers, those who have lightened up. Those are the fortunate ones. And you got to draw a hard line in the sand, you know, no drugs. You know, if you do it the right way, you got to begin developing discipline, mental toughness. Cannot boost it up. Cannot sit, no sex, no drugs, no rock and roll. Those don't work. Those are attempts to lighten it up. Okay, that's the ways we try to lighten it up. So sex, drugs, rock and roll, doesn't work. Ends up making things worse. So you have to discipline all of that stuff, and say, you know, no, mental discipline, practice, 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 wow, walk together in the wow, be exposed to that which is light, you know, which is lightened up, which is very lightened up, very much lightened up. And, you know, be brave enough to do that. You know, it'll be a shock. I mean, it's a shock for people when they come across someone who's really lightened up, that is light, you know, that has realized the light within them. It's a shock. But, you know, it's a necessary shock. It's like boot camp. You say, oh my gosh, you know, this is, I have to lighten up. How can I do that? Well, it's doable. It takes a little while, but it's doable. And gradually you can lighten up. And this, we did it in the 60s. A lot of people did. The people that really did lighten up in the 60s, you know, in the early 70s, they did lighten up. So, yeah, maybe I'll just lighten up. That's what I'm aiming for. And this will be helpful. This will be very helpful. But boy, the people are trying to lighten up in the wrong way in this world. That is for sure. And that just makes it heavier. It just makes the trip heavier. You got a bunch of people who are doing the wrong way. It makes it heavier for everybody else. It just adds to the weirdness of it all. It's getting too weird. Even young people say, this is getting too weird. I mean, I saw a guy today in that waiting room. Man, I'm telling you, this was too weird. It was too weird. I just had to look away. The guy, his movements, his whole vibe. This guy was uber weird. I mean, his entire body looked like it was just absolutely covered with tattoos. The way he, his hair, his hat, his clothes, his whole movements, his demeanor. I mean, he's just like, you know, I said, what planet is this guy from? He's like a different planet, really. Not a good one either. Sorry to say. Wow. This guy was tweaked to the max, I'm saying. Just, wow. Then there was some high patrol in there. And they were messed up. They were having problems. And somebody had to come and help calm them down. I mean, they're dealing with this. The police are dealing with all these tweakers and these people who are just flying low, you know, or how you put it, they're severely anti-rehab. They're having to deal with these people. I have the utmost compassion for the police and the job they're trying to do is so brutally difficult now. It's just ridiculously difficult. They're supposed to be sympathetic to all these people, but these people are acting very weird. They have to deal with all this extreme weirdness. Let alone all the severe crime and gangs, and it's just how do they do it? You know, they have to get heavy, right? And then they get blamed for getting heavy. Constantly, this social engineering is blaming the police for the problems. The world is getting out of control, and they have to try to keep control. As I've said, if the police leave an area, chaos. Criminals take over. This is a fact. Happened in Baltimore. Happened right here in Almaden Valley of San Jose, where the police basically, they cut all the police, and they said, we can't afford to police this area anymore. It's a low priority. We have to keep taking care of all these gangs on the east side. So we can't, there's no police there anymore. They just left the whole area open. And what happened? All the gang members went over there and started breaking into all the homes, terrorizing the whole area. This is what happens if there's no, the police are stand between us and chaos, actually. And here we are, 44, president is just tearing the police down, blaming the police, the police are the bad guys. It's social engineering, severe social engineering. And again, to deal with it, they get heavy. They have to get heavier, tougher, just like the guards at Guantanamo, deal with these extreme jihadists. They got really heavy. And you talk to them, they say, hey, it's really brutally difficult. You talk to this type of person, brutally difficult, they said. You don't know who we were dealing with. You don't get it. If you really knew, I talked to a prison guard. He said, if you knew who we were dealing with, you'd understand us. And I said, well, I believe what you're saying. His reason will tell me that what you're saying is reasonable. And he says, yeah, these people that we're dealing with are very, very violent criminals, tweakers, extreme drug addicts. These people are crazy. They're weird. And you just... it's so difficult to deal with them. They're not normal people at all. And so we have to, find ways to control the situation. It's super difficult. And the public, he says, that they're being misled. They're being misled. Blame the prison guards. Blame the police. Blame the authority. This kind of thing. Yeah. So what's the ultimate? As society collapses, thanks to these social engineers, what's what they want? They want chaos so then they can use, they want a crisis so they can then use the crisis to seize even greater power. This is the personality. This president right now, president number 44, is someone who the personality is in control of him. And he has a megalomaniacal personality, actually. And this is a very dangerous situation because they want even more authority. They want all authority. This is what the personality feels. To be safe, it has to control everything. He's not spiritual. He tries to make it seem like the personality is all great, so that means it is spiritual, but it's not at all. This is not the case at all. He's ignorant about that. Very ignorant. Doesn't really see any true role for this rehab program at all in the world that we've worked so hard to set up here. Sees no role for it at all. He says this needs to be... No role, get rid of it. I got something better program. Let's everybody do what I say. This is what the personality is like. And so, as part of the heaviness that is coming is to bring out this crisis and then say, get rid of law enforcement. Blame them for everything. This is very stupid. Catastrophically stupid. It brings about an El Nino of criminality in the world. So the only protection really at this point is say, I am the only authority there is, meaning spirit. Take all authority, stop projecting authority onto the personality and realize it has no authority. It's not a separate self. It doesn't exist except as a projection from the one mind, and take back the power that we're trying to give away. Take it back and own it. Realize it's mine. I am the only authority there is. Practice in this way, and then this will make you safe, actually. I realized this today. There's nothing that can happen to you at all when you assert your true authority. Nothing bad can happen. Nothing that you don't want happen can happen. And if something happens, you say, let me try to have it happen. You can fix it in an instant. Say, I don't want it to happen to me anymore. Boom. Stopped it. And if you're sick, you say, I don't want to be sick anymore. I have complete authority over the sickness, and you get well, just like that. This is where we have to go now. I mean, the personality is out of control in this world. The personality complex in this world is out of control. And you cannot try to match it with make your personality heavier and stronger, project more, more intense. That's not going to work. This will cause your downfall. So, all praise and glory to the great teachers who've shown us the right way to rehab, shown us how to lighten up. 27th here is a super auspicious day. The heart of auspiciousness here. It's the day we start lightening up. We just had the Day of the Dead here in San Jose. What was it, yesterday, the 25th or something? Day of the Dead, everybody wears dead masks and dressed up as dead people, and it's very morbid. And it's very, they say, oh, no, it's not morbid. We're just honoring, blah, blah, blah. Okay, right. Well, it is morbid. And we have this very morbid day, Halloween, coming up the 31st, which I detest Halloween. It's become an extremely morbid, kind of weird freak-out kind of situation in a lot of ways. People are, you know, just draping everything with spider webs right now and giant black widow spiders and stuff. That's what's the chic decor, you know. And you know, it used to be kids would dress up in funny Snow White costumes, funny costumes and whatever, and go trick-or-treat and get some candy, and that was it. It's become this very, very, very heavy, heavy, heavy thing now. It's detestable. So we need to lighten up before between the Day of the Dead and Halloween. We need to lighten up. We need, you know, we need the big, the heavyweights to, well, the heavy lightweights, the heavyweights who have, meaning the great lightweights, the ones that have lightened up, the great ones who have lightened up. We need them to come into the scene somehow. I need to lighten up too. You need to lighten up. We all need to lighten up. Let's do the lighten up. Let's not do the tighten up, you know, Archie Bell and the Drows. Let's do the lighten up. Someone needs to make a song. Let's do the lighten up. Come on, everybody, let's do the tighten up. It's really, doesn't that sound like a computer, like precursor to computer, the rhythm they had on that? I mean, it tightened you up. The whole way the song was, it tightened you up. Let's do the tighten up. We don't want to tighten up. We want to lighten up. Do the lighten up. Yeah, yeah. Come on, everybody. Let's do the lighten up. So, and then the end times, everybody will trying to lighten up, like dancing and, you know, feasting and drug taking and sex, drugs, rock and roll. They're desperately trying to light. It's too heavy, it's too heavy, it's too heavy, you know, it's getting too heavy. But that's not the way to lighten up. This fortunate ones will find some spiritual presence that is truly lightened up. Truly lightened up. More than just the rhetoric. You know, the rhetoric's not enough. It has to be genuinely lightened up. To do that, the only way is to bring your projections back home. Call your projections back home. There is no other way. As long as we're projecting, we won't be lightened up. So projecting a spiritual persona, that doesn't work. That's a personality thing, and that just makes it heavier ultimately. So no more projection. No more projection. Which means we'll really lighten up, and people will go, whoa, you know, whoa, what in the wow. This lady in the waiting room today, I was sat down looking around. I just looking around people, and she's like staring at me like bug eyed, and she sees me. Oh, stop staring at me like that! I said, "Why? What's going on?" I don't know. What am I, a Martian or something? And then later on, yeah, I was waiting. We wait a long time for the doctor. And I just kind of looking again. She's still staring at me like this. Staring. Oh, stopped. And the third time, she's looking at me, and she couldn't stop, like, just staring. She's like, I don't know. This happens a lot. Maybe I'm too much light, you know. Maybe this is like this light. I don't know what it is. Maybe the spiritual practice I've been doing is very helpful in that regard. But maybe I just look different. I got a different vibe, a very different vibe. I don't have that heavy vibe. I don't have that tattooed vibe. Don't have the criminal vibe, the gangster vibe, the rap vibe. Don't have the, the heavy vibe. That's not going on. The sick vibe. The, you know, all this stuff. I don't have it. Yeah, I seem to be, you know, so some blissful, just beneath the surface. Very blissful. Very light, just beneath the surface. So maybe that they're tuning into that. Maybe she was a psychic, feeling psychically. You know, some people tend to be, women often tend to be, their etheric body is a little looser, because they have children, so babies. So they can pick up stuff sometimes like that, and they say, you know, wow, what is that? men are taught to be denser, to struggle with the density of nature, you know, all this tough work that we have to do, eating the dust, you know, wow, nasty stuff. I know, I've been there and done that. It's not a joke. Like that guy, you know, driving that truck with 44,000 pounds in it. That is not a joke. That is really tough stuff. I drove a big truck once. That was scary. Holy cow. That was really, too much. I mean, that's a strain, that's a stress. You gotta be dense to handle that, you know, or maybe super light, I don't know. But you often see truck drivers, they're really heavy, they're really dense. I know a friend of mine I know drives a truck, heavy load. He carries the heaviest loads, real heavy stuff. He's really big, very, very heavy, very dense. It helps absorb the shock of the jolting of those trucks. You're driving those trucks, man. The shocks aren't like the sports cars we drive. I mean, you're jolted. And the roar of the engines and the vibration of the truck and everything. And you know, it is brutal. It's brutal stuff. You don't see many women. I saw a woman truck driver a couple of days ago. The first one I've seen in a long time. You don't see them very often. Very rare. I said, I did double take. Well, what? Here's a woman driving a truck driver. Very rare you see that. Because they generally don't have the density like that. You know, they're not able to be so dense. They're trying to get themselves more dense. This is what the big push is. They call it women's liberation. Let's be more dense, you know. Let's be dense like men. Stupid. I think men are tired of being dense, really tired of it, really. You know, enough of that, let's lighten up. But this lightening up is not meaning like let's become like women. No, they just have a slightly lesser density because they're etheric bodies, so they can have children. They need to be more flexible and such. But that's not a spiritual lighten up at all. That's still 100% personality. So when we say let's lighten up, this means a spiritual lightening up. Call all your projections back home. Now we've been misled, thinking, oh, men, you want to lighten up? Well, sure, you can be like women then, you know. So you got all these metrosexual types, you know, more like women. This is, we're very spiritual now. No, not at all. It has nothing to do with it. Nothing to do with it. It's a misdirection. And women tend to think, well, we don't need to be lighten up. We're already lighter than men, you know. We're less dense than them, so we don't need to do anything. No, they got to misconstruing what we mean by lighten up. Totally misconstruing it. Funny thing, tomorrow I'm actually driving a lighter vehicle. Very interesting. I have to bring a heavy vehicle in for work. Has to be work done. And so I'm driving this other vehicle, which is a lot lighter. Wow, that is very interesting. Good Lord, the symbology here, the synchronicity is astonishing. This is amazing, you know, when you see in hindsight, look, just the way our lives are orchestrated, it's really miraculous. I can't even explain it. It's so amazing. You just can't explain it, the timing of everything and how it happens. It's just inexplicable, really. And yet it's there. You know, just because we can't explain it doesn't mean it's not there. It is absolutely there. I've been delaying this repair work that for a long time, is very severe repair work is needed. And finally, I had to do it and set up a date tomorrow. I'm having it done. And it means I won't have the vehicle, so I have to use another vehicle, and that other vehicle's a lot lighter. right on the 27th, right on the 111th World Series, right on the, wow, everything just clickety click, 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 click. And I am losing weight quite a bit. In fact, I've lost a total of 15 pounds so far. And feels like it might go lower, actually. I'm just not eating heavy meals at all anymore. None. Very rarely, I would say. But no real heavy meals. Just not happening. Just not happening. What I have for dinner tonight? I just had some lettuce with some feta cheese on it. Some oil and vinegar, lettuce, and feta cheese with a tiny little golden potato, just a little small one, very small. That's it. Very light meal. Very, very light meal. Lunch was just some yogurt. Morning was a kale and fruit smoothie. That's it. So there's no heavy meals taking place, you know. With the heavy meal, you've got the, it takes seconds on the big plate of pasta with, you know, the a lot of bread, garlic bread, and the sauce and everything. You eat it, and then what do? You have seconds, and then, oh, it's good. Let me have thirds, and you have whole, and then you have some dessert after that. This, you know, this is a heavy meal. Heavy meal. That's how I was eating this summer. Heavy meals. And breakfast is like a big bowl of cereal with all sorts of stuff on the cereal, and just, you know, stuffs your stomach. Put the milk on, it all expands. Lunch is like a double cheese sandwich with all sorts of stuff on it, or a hamburger with, you know, loaded with, you know, two slabs of cheese. Veggie burger with a big bun and all the works, and then some, you know, macaroni salad to go with it. I mean, those are heavy meals. No more heavy meals. I've not had a heavy meal in about 56 days now. Hardly. There may have been a couple. I had to eat at, go to a restaurant or something, but even then I went pretty easy, but no more heavy meals. Lighten up. Lighten up. Do the lighten up. Come on, everybody. Let's do the lighten up. Maybe that's the title of this video. Come on, everybody. Let's do the lighten up. Yeah. I think people are having trouble right now because they're feeling this. Like, what do I do? What do I do? And they're trying to get heavier, and this is a problem. But this is fine. Once I lighten up, God willing, it'll change people. Because people will say, "Hey, wait a minute. You know, maybe we can do this." But it has to be a real lighten up. It has to really be significant lightening. It can't just be a personality rhetoric of lightening. It has to actually be lighten up, and then they may say, "Hey, let's get with this now. Time to get with it." Absolutely is. 111th World Series. This is what I saw in the symbology of the dream. This is when the heaviness falls upon everyone, and we need to escape that heaviness. There's going to be a severe heaviness come across the world now. Severe heaviness. And you can feel it. You don't have to detail it. You just feel it. You say, "This trip's getting too heavy for me." And you just see that in the TV and the advertising and everywhere. You just go into a medical clinic, okay, and tell me it's not getting too heavy. I was just there today. I said, "This is too much. This is too much." The nurses, I mean, my God, what's happened to the nurses' profession? You know, I mean, they're all freaked out too. They're all tripped out. They're all tattooed out. It's so different than 20 years ago. You can't even believe it. I said, "This is the admitting nurse. These are the nurses. What?" I could tell they're all messed up. They have, of course. "Oh, I'm sorry. Oh, okay. We'll look into that." They still have the nurse. You know, they play this little nurse game. You know, but you can, their hair, the way they look, the whole. You know, they are hard scrabble, you know. Not like it used to be at all. You know, the nurses used to be Florence Nightingale. Not anymore. They got tattoos of dragons all over their necks. You know, they still try to have a pleasant enough demeanor, but you can just see, just the, wow, you talk about, look like sewer rats. You know, I was in a sewer, there's sewer rats, the people look like sewer rats. People look like sewer rats, they really do. Good Lord, I mean, the women in there too, I mean, you talk about, to let themselves go, you know, it's crazy. Wow, it's getting too heavy for the women too. I mean, just the way they were dressing and looking and everything. Yeah, rarely do you see, you know, you don't see the women like they used to be at all. You just don't see it. You do not see it anymore. They're trying. Oh, yeah, got the, you know, the spandex on, you know, but you could just tell they're falling apart. They're falling apart. Because again, women can fake it longer. The etheric body's looser, less dense. They can seem fresher and more supple for a longer time than men. So they can have the same mental problems, but it doesn't show up as quickly as it does in men. And they can fake it for a longer time. You know, makeup and various ways they do, they fake it. But they're still falling apart. They're still falling apart. It's still affecting them. It just... You know, that's not quite as evident as early as men. In men, you can see it more, it's more evident, easier to see. But I was seeing that the women are falling apart. Absolutely falling apart. It's not a good thing. You know, the children being raised in that sort of environment. They're all going gangsta, you know, the whole culture is. Or they're just, you know, try to be the prince, personality princess thing if they have the money. But that's all fake too. They're falling apart too. You know, they fake it so much. And you see in their face, just look. It's just, you know, it's right blatant, obvious. What do you need to do? It's just, they're just like, you know, this is too heavy for me. I'm getting crushed. It's too heavy. The whole thing's too heavy right now. You can tell their spirit is just being crushed, you know. Where is the lighten up? You know, where is not, it doesn't exist anymore. I mean, the 60s doesn't exist anymore in terms of people really, really being, you know, lightening up and being, you know, it just, it's a rare bird. Avis rara. Rara avis to rare bird that is like that way. I mean, super rare. I just don't see it anymore. Someone who's just flowing. Someone who's just light and flowing. Now, everybody's staggering right now. They're staggering. They're dragging. They're trying to fight it off with yoga or something. But no, you look at their faces and say, we're getting clobbered. You know, we're just getting clobbered. And this is true. This is true. So, let's say, come on, everybody, let's do the lighten up. Let that be our resolve. Come on, everybody, let's do the lighten up. Come on, everybody, let's do the lighten up. And yeah, you people don't want the teachers from the past because they're not here. They say they're not here. Well, that's understandable. They are here, but they're not, you know, embodied, so to speak. Their attitude is still here. You know, actually, their vibe is still here. You just have to tune into it. It never leaves, actually. So Jesus says, once someone extends peace to everyone, this never leaves. It's permanent. But I understand that people want some of us here that are, quote unquote, that are projecting a body. They want, you know, they want to see that lighten up. because everyone, they're projecting the body too, but they still think it's a personality thing. They say, well, yeah, I got to make a light personality. So they don't understand that it means calling the personality back home and not projecting it anymore. That's how you really lighten up. They don't understand that. Almost nobody understands that here. But they'll still get the feeling of lightening up, and they might start thinking like, hey, you know, I need to start disciplining myself here because I want to get this and I'm not really getting it. So we'll see if it's too little too late or whatever it's going to go on. I don't know, but happy 27th of October. This is super auspicious. We're going to go for it. Let's everybody do the lighten up and just enjoy the lighten up. You know, it's better than the 60s. In some ways, it'll be better than the 60s. For me, I know it will be. I will be because I have perspective, have hindsight, have true perspective. We didn't know what we were doing back then. We were just saying, help, you know. Now, some of us know what we're doing in terms of clarity about the whole spiritual path and everything. It's no longer just some sort of mystical thing from Shambhala. You know, no, it is not at all. It's right here, right now. Fully aware of it, you know, clear about it. Different story now. So we'll see how it goes. But you know, don't lose hope right now. I understand it's the heaviness is upon us severely. But hey, everybody, let's do the lighten up. And we will. All right. Very great. That's it for this one.